What's up, people? It's me and, you know, thoughts and crazy things and, you know, but it's one of those mornings, you know, it's just like, I don't even know why I'm here or what I'm doing. It's like the calculator's not working. I don't even have my shoes and socks on yet. I just rolled out of bed. It's late. I'm tired. I haven't had any tea. I'm just not feeling this, but my role in the world is obviously that I have to come online here to YouTube and sell fish, so, you know, get her done. It's like the world doesn't stop. It's got to go on. It's got to happen no matter what. And so I'm here, and I'm barefoot, but I'm going to solve that problem right now. Put my shoes in. Socks on 1 foot at a time, just like everybody else does. And it doesn't have to inhibit me making this video. You know, I wanted to make this video with a nice set behind me, and I don't get to because those sets are all at the cleaners, and I'm left with nothing but the blank, infinitely white wall full of shadows. And it's not good theater. It's really not good to hear. It's really just, it's terrible. But hey, you know what? The show must go on. So, here we go. Today I'm going to just drop another episode of Dear Dude. Thanks for coming by, all two of you, and watching this. And let's go at it, shall we? So, the concern that I wanted to talk about today is one that has been levied against me from the very beginning. The institution of none and all is many things to many people, but for me, it began in December 19th, 1999. It was a moment where I had a visionary revelatory experience that descended upon me and attached itself to my existence, every aspect of my existence, and it would not let go of me. It absolutely would not let go of me, and the spirit, the character, the nature that descended upon me was literally the living embodiment, the physical manifestation of Christ into the world. And we can talk about that another time. But the first response that I had was, what? Me? Wrong. Wrong. Like Dennis Hopper in, you know, Apocalypse Now. That was, you think I'm going to fix all this shit, man? Me, wrong, wrong. And I wanted to point to somebody else and say, you guy, you there, you do it. And the universe went through a system of checks and balances with me that was kind of like, no hands but ours, no eyes but ours, no tongue but ours, no feet but ours, no nothing but nothing, right? You do this and get her done, and no matter how many other people go at it, no matter how many other people try, and no matter how, it's not beholden upon you to compete with them, it's not beholden upon you to be better than them, it's not beholden upon you to be perfect, it's not beholden upon you to do it right, it's beholden upon you to do it. Okay, so I took this information to my good friend and I said, hey buddy, like, this thing happened to me and now I have to live my whole life in this new way. And it's not necessarily new because I had already been brought up through the spiritual tradition and I was already an ascetic and I had already committed myself to spiritual pursuits and everything, but I had never committed myself to portraying the embodiment of holiness. And I knew that because I am a glutton and a wine bibber and, my tongue is very sharp, it's very rough, I something of a dickhead apparently to everybody I know. Everyone has always told me, Chris, why are you such an asshole? I'm angry or something. Although I feel like that's a virtue, it's a gift. Especially in the world we're living in today, my opinion is that if you're not angry, you're not paying attention, there's something wrong with you. If you're well adjusted and you're happy and you're doing well in this society that does what it does and takes what it takes from the earth and from others, and my attitude was that, you know, that there's something wrong with that. But other people don't see things like that. They want to be bathed in this white, perfect, redeeming, salvatory, salvific light. They want everything to be light and love. They want God to be perfect. They want God to be a constant manifestation of love towards them and abundance towards them. They want God to be a source of solutions, a source of smooth sailing. They want God to just really unlock paradisiacal glory to them. They don't want or need or have any appreciation for a God that throws stumbling blocks in front of them or tries to confuse them or is a trickster or a prankster. They don't want any raven or coyote. They don't want any Dionysus. They don't want any Loki. They don't want any aspect of the divine that they perceive as negative, which is actually a horrible appropriation of an otherwise meaningful term that makes it completely meaningless. But that's the thing, is that people, and myself included, and everyone I've never known, has said the same thing. Hey, you're not the one. You can't be the one. You're a pig. And that's fair criticism. Now, there's this whole side of this, and I wanted to expand upon this in another video entirely, so I'm going to try to avoid expanding upon it in this video. But there's this whole side of this Christ character. There's this whole side of spiritual awareness. There's this whole side of holiness that I call the whole holy whole. The whole, H-W-H-O-L-E, the whole, as in the all-encompassing. Holy, as in, oh, so holy. And then whole, as in H-O-L-E, fall into a pit. And the whole holy hole is exactly what somebody else already left in the comment stream. It's blind people leading blind people into problems. And that's the question on life. You know, that's the true question on life. Is that a pit or is it a storage container? Is that a stumbling block or a stepping stone? Is that glass half full or is it half empty? And the relationships between these two things are often blurred. They're difficult to separate out. And there's a nuanced version of all of this. There's a less of a Sunday school version, less of a childish version. This is one of the great critiques of the new atheist crowd, of course, is that if God exists, why isn't God perfect? God can't exist because God is not perfect. There is no shortage of people in this world who have said to themselves, I'm not going to believe in any kind of divinity or any kind of God that allows suffering, that worked death into the deal, that creates paradoxes that are uncomfortable and that are difficult to think about. Most people just don't have the time or the interest or the inclination to be part of any kind of spiritual experience that just isn't nothing like milk. You know, one solution to all problems, love and light. You know, and that's really a superficial. In my opinion, at this point in my life, that's a superficial exposition of, it's a superficial exploration, it's a superficial explanation of the religious and spiritual experience. So I think the reality here, and this is the kind of the bottom line stamp on this thing, 10 minutes in, I get to the point. The imperfections are possibly worth more than you think. And the depth and the character that is created by these what seem like cracks and fissures in the integrity of my message are actually the rich points that give you something to dive into. It has been suggested, for example, that the Urantia book, which I have not read all of it, and I haven't read this specific passage from it. And I think the Urantia book's cool. I think it's a good modern scripture. I think that it has a lot to say, and I think everything that I've read in there so far is worthy of my attention. But I halt at the same place with the Urantia book that I halt with every book. Even at some points the Tao, I halt to say that it is a perfect expression of knowledge. It is historically specific, it's linguistically specific, and if you try to one size fits all love and light nail that on to everyone's experience the whole world over, it's not effective. And one of the things that the Urantia book has suggested is that the only way for the avatar perspective, the only way for the Christ consciousness to be effective, the only way for shift to actually happen, and the only way for God to be recognized amongst people is for God's grace to be eternal, everlasting, perfect, unbinding, like un-unbindable. It's completely irrefutable. It's absolute. It is not dynamic. It's not comprehensive. It's not a cohesion. It is a singularity. And I obviously am doing something else here. I am suggesting a unity of duality. I am suggesting a grace of imperfection. I am suggesting that you don't need to be perfected. I am suggesting that it doesn't matter if I'm a glutton and a wine bibber and an asshole. I am suggesting that my works and my deeds and my aims and the entirety of my message, the entirety of my purpose, has to be judged on the merits of itself. It can't be judged on me as a character delivering it. It can't be judged on, am I good enough to make this, to flip this trick? Am I good enough to tell this tale? Am I good enough to write this poem? I'm not good enough to tell this tale. I'm not good enough to write this poem. I'm a flawed and perfect beast of a human being. I have anger, and I have rudeness, and I swear, my tongue is filthy, my habits are deplorable, I'm lazy, I'm weak-minded, I'm not as studious as I should be, and in many ways what I'm doing here is making a mockery of the narrower perspective that people would prefer to see. However, for some people, the salvation lies in the assurance that this thing is not far from them. But the salvation lies in the assurance that this thing is imperfected and that there is perfection in that. For many people, the assurance lies in seeing a avatar god type character, etc., an ascended master, an Atman, who lives life normal and is like others and has the same problems and concerns and shortcomings and drawbacks. That message doesn't give them a perfect, unattainable reality that's beyond them. It gives them a transcendent reality that is present. And that is, in many ways, the secret nature of Christ consciousness, is that it will feed on what's wrong with the world? What's wrong with this video? What's wrong with the dude? What's wrong with the people? And it will take that, whatever is wrong, and it will say, no, no sin here. This isn't wrong. There isn't something bad about this. And that's a difficult concept for people to understand. It turns people away. It creates atheists out of people on a regular basis. And it is the deepest, it's actually not probably the deepest, but it's one of the deeper pools of the Christ consciousness that that people can arrive at. And so I am going to apologize to everybody. I'm sorry that I'm not what you want me to be. I'm sorry that my blood is not red enough. I'm sorry that my light is not white enough. I'm sorry that my backgrounds are not interesting. I'm sorry that I'm shooting these on a calculator. I'm sorry that I have bad sound levels. I'm sorry that I talk in circles. I'm sorry that I seem like an idiot. I'm sorry that I'm rude. I'm sorry that I'm angry. I'm sorry that I don't give you something perfect to cling to. I'm sorry that I am creating a vacuum and basically inviting you to jump into it. And I think there's value in that, and I think if you have the strength of mind and the depth of character to jump into that thing, you will appreciate it. And I understand that that's a kind of a self-fulfilling guarantee, and such is the nature of spiritual wisdom, and such is the nature of people who share it, and such is the jumping off point for the rich tapestry of paradox that influences this discussion. And I'm sorry that people want it to be a singularity. I'm sorry that people want it to be all love and all light and all perfection and absolutely wonderful. And I'm sorry that I have to try to sew this thing together entirely out of flaws and good intentions. We're working with reality, and a reality that is colored by emotional experiences, and a reality that is colored by sociolinguistics. It's a reality that's colored by social facts. It's a reality that's colored by people's desires and assumptions. And it's a reality that on every level is both a conglomeration of independent perspectives and a totalizing truth of all perspectives at once. And you can't share a totalizing truth of all perspectives at once if all you have is a love and light now. I'm sorry I'm not a love and light now. I'm sorry that I'm not the perfect being that you want me to be. I am deliciously flawed, and that's where my ability to selfish comes from. So if you're dissuaded to take anything else the dude says as gospel because he has admitted that he and the Father are not one, but he is alike. And the idea that the Father, in and of itself, is not a perfect being. The Father is a flawed being that, when you become a father, you understand the pressure that your father went through. And if you look back on your father and you have criticism of him, once you become a father, suddenly that criticism becomes much more meaningful. Anyway, that's it. That's the point. Love is not a simple, straightforward business. If you are a parent, if you are a father, your love is often a refusal. It's often a discipline. It's often a harsh word. Because there are times when not refusing, not disciplining, and not offering a harsh word to your child is the mistake. That's the wrong thing to do. love is difficult, and when you are responsible for another being, it's your responsibility to make tough decisions sometimes, and sometimes those decisions don't entirely look like love, but they are love, because love's complicated. Love is not an absence of pain. It is not an absence of suffering. It is not an absence of everything that you don't like. Love is the inclusion of everything that you don't like. True love, transcendent love, God's love, is love even for those who have swollen tongues and cheap calculators and stupid videos, right? That's the shadows, the darkness, the whole universal model. It doesn't work without these other aspects of the person. And as I said, still, there's a way and a time to cut off the hand, to pluck out the eye. There are points of no return. There are lines in the sand which must not be crossed, right? But even if you cross those lines in the sand, there has to be a way back. There has to be a redeeming value. And there has to be a hand extended saying, please, give me your hand. Come with me. I will take you there. And that can't come to you from the glorious divine wonder, the perfection of the universe. It can't come to you at your lowest point from that source. That source is not visible at your lowest point. For somebody to climb down into the pit with you and say, I'm sorry, but you're blind and you've fallen into this pit, climb on my back and I will sledge through the mud to get you up out of here and back into the light, and then I will spit into that mud and rub it into your eyes so that you can see now. You understand? It's not perfect business. It's messy. It's sticky. It's disgusting. It's hard work. It's not light work. It's heavy work. And I've explained this before, and I'm not going to explain it again for a while.